This shows the monitoring site that we're going to be talking about. There is a major expressway over here and some major roads into the urban part of the city that are fairly close to the monitoring site. Denver is not a very industrial city. There is some petroleum refining and so on that is much nearer the other monitoring site that this instrument operated at. But this is a downtown urban site. This is on the edge of the university campus. The compounds that we will talk about are this subset of compounds. These are the Roy C6 to C12 compounds. These will be ones that we quantify from them, from that, that had enough data to be useful for further modeling the BMN work. So there are a number of compounds that we may have only detected 50-70% of the time that we took out this subset of the data. This is hourly benzene data for September through February time period. And obviously, there's a lot of variability. These are fairly high concentrations. The data has been validated as well as it can be validated. So now we're looking at some PMF results. This data, the results we'll look at are based on six factors, and I'll tell you what those are in a few minutes. But this is looking at what you would calculate from the PMF results versus the observed concentrations, and hexane is very good. The blue line here is the 1-to-1 line. There's a red dashed line, which is the regression line, and those are almost on top of each other. Here you can see benzene. There's some benzene now here that isn't dealt with particularly well. There's some toluene down here that isn't cyclohexane has some stuff down here that isn't done particularly well. But many of these do reasonably well. Octane isn't in too good a shape, but there are some reasons for that. I'll mention when we look at some of the factors. But the goal is to be able to explain much of the variability in the various compounds in the mix that we're looking at. We have six factors. One of them, factor three, is really an artifact factor. Going back and looking at some of the time series data, what we'll see step at baseline that I'll show you later. And in this case, 2-methylheptane, 3-methylheptane, styrene, orthotoluene, N-undecane, those were things that baseline moved detectively for each of those compounds, and I could have pulled that data out altogether. I was trying to salvage it, and I'm not sure that that was the best approach. I think I will go back and pull it out and see if I can get a better description of things. But PMF pulled it out for me. And those things move together because of the artifact of the data. And it's not all of those compounds that you're describing this way, but it's enough of it, a large that's why I would go back and pull them out and see if it cleans things up a little bit better. There is a factor here that has a lot of 1,3,5 trimethylbenzene, some other larger aromatics. Where it comes from, I don't know. I'm guessing it is a refining factor of some sort. There's a factor down here that is alkanes that is separate from fuel-related alkanes that moves differently, separated from it. Doesn't have the kinds of aromatics that you would expect to see in most of the fuel components. The toluene is very low. What this is, I'm not sure. There's more low molecular weight stuff than I would have expected from a diesel. Not sure what it is, but it's there. The other three factors are factors that I don't feel too bad about the identification. This factor looks like liquid gasoline. And you can see the concentrations in the bar of various species in the factor, and the red dot is the percent of that species that is being explained by this factor. So the toluene is the biggest bar here, but it's about 20-25% of the toluene is coming from this liquid gasoline factor. Okay? This is liquid gasoline data from California work. This is an ethanol blended gasoline, which is what is being used, 10% ethanol blend is most of what is being used during this time period in Colorado. Biggest concentration is toluene. A lot of N-P-xylene, both of those are very big in the factor that we see. There are the 2,2,4 trimethylbenzene, which is a fuel and fuel evaporation factor commonly. It's also one of those things that are buried in the artifacts. And so it isn't showing up in this. It's showing up in the liquid factor. It isn't showing up in the liquid gasoline analysis. It will show up in the volatility in the evaporative fuel component. So factor two is liquid gasoline. This is evaporative, so you've got more of the light part, and this is the evaporative emissions from the 10% splash blend. And while we're here, there is, US EPA has a speciate database, and I think somewhere in these slides, I'm not sure where, somewhere in these slides is the link to that database. But it has source profiles for all kinds of things. And when you don't have anything else, it's a good place to start. And it has doubled in size in the last 5-ish years, so it's added a lot more modern information as well. There's some very old stuff, and there's some much newer stuff. But there are a lot of different kinds of source profiles that are kind of useful. This particular fuel evaporative profile comes from species. This is vehicle exhaust profile, and this is a ton of data that is similar and part of the rationale for identifying this factor as a good. So the only factors that are interpreter role, in my opinion, of the three that I have named with the side. The other contributions aren't particularly interpretable. So this is benzene over here. So we've got liquid fuel, evaporating and exhaust. There's a small amount of benzene that came from factor three, which I think that's buried in its artifact factor, so that's a small amount of it that's affected by the shields. So that is part of it, you don't really hear about at all. Contributions for hexane, cyclohexane, toluene, ethylbenzene, xylenes, exhaust is a big part of the contribution. It isn't clear that there's much that is not vehicle related at this site, and that's really the expectation because there's no industry nearby. All vehicles in that immediate area. The other site has more industrial input. It has more diesel vehicle input because there's a lot of truck and frame activity in the other area. The measurements there were March, April, May kinds of measurements. That is a relatively windy time of the year and relatively low concentrations. The data set isn't as useful for looking at source information during that period of time. You have more than some data to deal with and not detect some things of that variety. And so I haven't messed with that data, which might have been more interesting from the industrial perspective. Diurnal profiles, these are diurnal profiles of the three factors we don't understand very well. The artifact is this green factor, and the diurnal profiles have normal atmospheric concentration profiles for the most part. The liquid fuel profile is the only one that looks different. It looks like it's more a constant source because it's night concentrations are relatively high. It drops during the day when mixing is better and dilution is better. But it may be a more constant source, whatever that source is, whatever the fuel really is. That's a fairly common factor that many of these analyses will see something that looks like a little bit fuel. The limitation is, what are these factors? Most of the time, you can pull out the fuel evaporation and the exhaust emissions fairly well from the data, if they're important most of the time. But identifying other pieces
are difficult
without source-specific profile.